Dear learners, welcome to the course on sociology at the senior secondary level. I am Dr. Elena Samantraya, working at V.V. Giri National Labour Institute. Today, we will discuss the lesson on marriage. Let us discuss first the meaning of marriage. Learners, you must be aware that marriage is an important institution and it binds men and women into a family relationship. Marriage is an institution which actually admits men and women to family life. Many sociologists have worked on the institution of marriage, and many scholars who have worked on this institution have provided several definitions of marriage. Edward Westermarck, in his book The History of Human Marriage in 1891, says that marriage is more or less durable connection between male and females, lasting beyond the mere act of propagation till after the birth of the offspring. So learners, as we now know that marriage is a very important institution that binds human beings into a social life, into a family life. You all know that in family, the first process of socialization starts. Family is an important agency where the process of socialization starts, and marriage admits people into family life. So marriage becomes a very important institution where people grow together and follow the norms and regulations of society and have a socially ordered life. Now let us discuss on the types of marriage. We all know that several societies have various types of marriage, and marriage has been since times immemorial been interpreted in different ways, and actually the institution has undergone also tremendous changes over the years in various forms. So previously, when we look into the institution of marriage, we see that many societies have different types of marriage. Marriage, first of all, can be monogamous or polygamous. We all know that monogamy is a very important and prevalent institution of marriage which has been existing in several societies. So learners, you will see when we look into the typology or the types of marriage, we see that marriage is divided into monogamy and polygamy. The institution of marriage as polygamy is further divided into polygyny and polyandry, and we will have several examples both in the West and in the Indian society where you see all these forms of marriage. Now let us understand what is monogamy. So marriage on the basis of number of mates can be divided into monogamy and polygamy. As we all know, since times immemorial, we have been witnessing monogamy as the most prevalent form of marriage, where one man marries one woman or one woman marries one man. And this kind of marriage has been prevalent in India and many other societies. Around more than 70-80% of the population across the world practice this form of marriage, and we know this as a very popular form of marriage. Now let us understand polygamy. Polygamy is a form of marriage in which a man or woman is permitted to marry more than one man or woman. We have seen, as you all know learners, that this kind of marriage was also prevalent a long time when we look into the historical texts and historical epics of India, where we have seen a woman marrying several men or a man marrying several women. In the other parts of the world, example in Northern Africa or Eastern Asia, this kind of marriage was prevalent. And you can see polygamous marriages, which is further divided into polygyny and polyandry, can be understood differently. Polygyny is a kind of marriage where one man marries several women, and this is also found in Islamic societies. Polyandrous marriages is found where a woman marries several men or a woman marries several brothers at the same time. It is prevalent in tribal societies. Many tribal societies like the Todas of the Nilgiris practice polyandrous marriages, and many other tribal communities in India and elsewhere, they also practice polyandrous marriages. Learners, now let us understand the institution of marriage in terms of certain rules. Every institution like marriage has certain prescriptive and preferential rules. These rules are very important when we understand or when we opt for spouse selection. And as we all know, learners, that marriage is an institution which regulates certain behavior pattern of human beings in every societies. So when we look into the rules of spouse selection, we see there are two sets of rules. One is prohibitive rules and the other one is prescriptive rules. We have seen Indian society has witnessed several of these rules, and several of these rules are still prevalent in many parts and many communities of India. Let us see what are prohibitive rules. Prohibitive rules, as you all must have learnt about or known about, certain kinds of prohibitions which the society exercises on individuals. The first kind of it is incest taboo. Incest taboo is a relationship which is generally avoided by people belonging, having a blood relationship. Sexual or marital relations between persons who are related by blood, marriage among such relationships or such blood ties are strictly prohibited. Many communities in the Indian society, they practice incest taboo. For example, marriage among cousins. Marriage among cousins is strictly prohibited in many parts of India. Though we see that certain religious communities, certain other tribal communities and other communities in the southern part of India do have marital ties with their close bonds, but in larger part of India, marriage within blood ties is strictly prohibited. This kind of rule is called incest taboo. The second one is exogamy. Exogamy is individuals marrying outside a specific group. We see that many marriage within the group in certain communities are avoided. So that is why many people marry outside a specific group. They do not marry within their own communities. Endogamy is another rule where marriage within one's own social group is prohibited. You must have seen in Hindu communities in India, we have people belonging to the same gotra. So marriage within members of the same gotra is prohibited. So endogamy is marriage within one's social group. Previously in Indian society, when we look into caste groups particularly, marriage within certain castes was strictly prohibited. Though now after the inter-caste marriages are now legalized. So endogamous rules were strictly followed in the past in Indian society. Now let us understand the other kinds of prohibitive rules. We have a kind of rule which is called hypergamy or anuloma, where a boy from an upper caste marries a girl from a lower caste. As we all know that Indian society had practiced endogamous marriages in the past. Similarly, hypergamy is one kind of marriage where they are marrying outside their own group, but it is a marriage of two different castes. A boy belonging to upper caste marries a girl from a lower caste. Hypogamy or pratiloma is another kind of marriage where a boy from a lower caste marries a girl from a higher caste. So when we look into these kinds of prohibitive rules and people or in communities in the past, people who had undergone or people who had practiced such marriages were strictly punished by the village community. Though now presently the institution of marriage has undergone several changes and these rules have undergone several changes. Learners, now let us understand the prescriptive or preferential rules. You must have known in many parts of India that parallel cousin marriages are strictly prohibited. So marriage between children of either two brothers or sisters are not preferred or are prohibited. These are preferential rules. But among certain communities where you have marriage between children of either two brothers or sisters, like the Muslim community, which allows flexibility in these rules, their marriage happens. So this is parallel cousin marriage. The other kind of preferential rule is cross cousin marriages. Marriage of a boy or a girl, marriage of a boy specifically with the maternal uncle's daughter or paternal aunt's daughter. We have seen such cross-cousin marriages, though not prevalent in larger part of India, but they are found in certain tribal communities like the Gonds of MPs, the Oraons and the Kariyas of Jharkhand. So we have among certain tribal communities cross-cousin marriages being practiced. Another important preferential rule which was practiced in many communities in India is levirate. It's a custom in which a widow marries her husband's brother. This kind of marriage is found among the Toda communities or the Toda groups. Sororate is another kind of custom in which a widower marries the younger sister of the deceased wife. It is also found in certain tribal communities like the Gonds or the Baigas. So these are the two kinds of rules on spouse selection which are practiced differently in different parts of the Indian society. Learners, now let us move on to the functions of marriage. Marriage as an institution, we know in the society, has several important functions to play. And many scholars, including Gooday and Malinowski, sociological scholars, have reiterated that marriage and as an institution, if it does not get legalized or if there is no marital bond, then procreation, upbringing of children or legal upbringing of children is not possible. So marriage has definitely important functions to play. One of the prominent functions of marriage is procreation and nurturing of children. So as we all know that the first agency of socialization is family, and marriage is an institution that allows in creation of the institution of family. So marriage allows for the procreation and nurturing of children. Marriage also allows for economic cooperation and security. We all know the institution of marriage acts as a provider of economic security and cooperation. During emotional turmoils, during difficult times, during problems, marriage is an institution where members who are into a marital bond, the husband, wife and children, are closely knit with each other and look at each other for cooperation and security. The third important function of marriage is companionship and emotional support. Marriage is an institution which is based on the philosophy of companionship and emotional support. Marriage through the institution of family provides immense amount of emotional support to its family members. During distress or during problems, the family members or members who are into a marital relationship are and then formed a family, children go to their parents and share their problems. So marriage acts as an important bedrock where emotional relations are formed and where there is immense emotional support for children and for those who are tied in the marital bond. Learners, now let us move on to Hindu marriage. We know that Hindu marriage is the most prevalent form of marriage in India. Hindu marriage is termed or is understood as a religious sacrament. You all must have seen that when we talk about Hindu marriage, immediately the idea of rituals, ceremonies, the sacred fire, and many things come to our mind. So Hindu marriage, as interpreted in legal Hindu texts of the lawgivers in the ancient past, is termed as a religious sanskar. Sanskar means a religious duty. So Hindu marriage is seen as a religious sanskar. The main objectives of Hindu marriage is performance of religious duty, which is dharma, giving birth to children, which is praja, and satisfaction of sexual desires, which is rati. So Hindu marriage, we have seen various rituals are performed when a Hindu marriage ceremony is taking place, like Kanyadan, Saptapadi and many other rituals. Hindu marriage is performed in front of the sacred fire, and after Hindus get married, they go into the ashram scheme or the ashram life where Grihastha ashram is termed as a prominent ashram which allows marital bond to remain. So Hindu marriage allows both men and women to perform their religious duty, and hence it is considered as a sanskar or a religious duty for the propagation of the family and for maintaining social obligations. Hindu marriage is a religious sacrament, as we now just learned. You can see that Hindu marriage is performed in front of the sacred fire or Agni, and Hindu marriage is performed with full recitation of hymns through a religious ceremony. Learners, now let us move on to Muslim marriage. Muslim marriage is generally understood as a contract. Muslim marriage, which is popularly known as nikah, is a civil contract between a man and a woman. It is solemnized in the presence of witnesses, including the priest, who is called a maulvi. Dower or mehr is paid by the husband to the wife. So Muslim marriage is undertaken in the form of a civil contract where the priest or the maulvi recites the hymns and where they sign the contract and accept the marital bond. Learners, now let us move on to see how the nikah ceremony takes place. We see that in a nikah ceremony, the maulvi plays a very prominent role in asking both the bride and bridegroom the clauses of the marriage and in the acceptance of the whole marital bond. Learners, now let us see how changes have taken place in the institution of marriage. As we all learned that marriage is an important social institution in every society that binds human beings into social relationships. And in every society, different kinds of marital bonds are prevalent, which binds human beings into societal bonds and helps them to discharge their social obligations. Marriage also regulates human behavior. Over the time, the institution of marriage has undergone several changes. Right from the historical past till now, this institution has changed tremendously. And many of the changes post-industrialization has taken place. Changes in the form of marriage, as we see, from plurality to monogamy. Now, monogamous form of marriages is accepted as mostly prevalent form of marriage. The process of selection of partner has also undergone several changes. Previously, marriage endogamous relationship, marriage within the caste group was accepted. Marriage outside the caste was not accepted, was a taboo, and people who had practiced such kind of marriages were ostracized from the village communities. But with the passage of time and with very proactive legislations of the government of India, such rigid orthodox practices have dissolved, and we see now that both the boy and the girl have a say in the decision making when it comes to spouse selection. So the process of selection of partner has also gone under tremendous changes. The Special Marriage Act 1954 is an important piece of legislation which has legalized or recognized intercaste and interreligious marriages. Earlier, intercaste marriages and interreligious marriages were not accepted in Indian society, and people were ostracized and people were looked down upon in village communities if they practiced such kind of marriages. But with this kind of legislation, which is a very proactive legislation, such marriages are legally recognized. So marriage as an institution has undergone several changes over many years, and still it is undergoing changes. The Special Marriage Act of 1954 has legally recognized intercaste and interreligious marriages. We now see that intercaste marriages is highly prevalent in Indian society, and many boys and girls are accepting their partners of their choice through these kind of marriages. Now let us see the other changes in the institution of marriage. The Hindu Marriage Act 1955 has stipulated the age of marriage. Earlier, in Indian society, child marriages were practiced and children were victims of child marriages. Very early age, children were getting married and group marriages were also happening among children. In order to prohibit such practices, the Hindu Marriage Act was passed, and Hindu Marriage Act actually stipulates the marriageable age for boys and girls. For boys, it is 21 and for girls, it is 18 years. So any boy or girl who has not achieved this age should not be legally accepted to marry as per the Hindu Marriage Act of 1955. The Widow Remarriage Act of 1856 had been an intervention, an effort of many reformers, social reformers in the past. The Widow Remarriage Act is against the practice of not allowing widows to get married again. In Indian society, as we had seen, due to child marriages and early practices of such marriages, many of the girl children used to lose their husbands at a very young age. And widow remarriage was strictly prohibited due to Hindu cultural norms and values. Such practices were challenged through the Widow Remarriage Act of 1856, and widow remarriage was permitted under this act. The next is the Dowry Prohibition Act of 1961. Taking and accepting dowry or demanding dowry is an offense in the Indian society presently. The government has passed the Dowry Prohibition Act, and as per the act, it is a punishable offense to ask for dowry or any kind of monetary benefit from the bride's parents. And if they are caught, they will be penalized, and there are penal provisions under this act for people who are practicing or taking dowry in any form. Learners, we learnt many important things on the institution of marriage today. I am sure that today's lesson on the institution of marriage will make you understand how the institution of marriage from the historical past has undergone several changes, and yet it remains an important institution in every human society to fulfill social obligations and duties as a member of society. Thank you.